Hello everybody, welcome to this morning's webinar on the characterisation and assessment of surfaces and coatings for advanced engineering applications, presented by Alan Taylor. If you have any questions, there will be please put them in the Q&A box and Alan will answer them at the end of the webinar. Over to you, Alan.
Thanks, Becky. Hello everybody, my pleasure to be here to give this this webinar. So as Becky says, please put any questions in the Q&A and I'll do my best to answer them at the end. If we run out of time at the end, then my contact details are on the final slide, so you can contact me directly and I'll respond after the in the next day or so. Anyway, so moving swiftly along onto the topic of the characterisation and assessment of surfaces and coatings. Why is this important? Well, actually, surfaces are a critical part of any engineered product. It's often where problems start to arise. It's often the thing that the client will first see. So actually, visibility, aesthetics, identification is actually critically important. Functionality is a key aspect of surfaces. Often surfaces are, coatings are put down onto engineered components in order to provide a degree of enhancement to the functional performance. So for example, infrared reflectivity, scratch or abrasion resistance, friction modification. Often corrosion protection is one of the things that we are interested in because we'd like to make our components out of a material that's got a set of mechanical properties but perhaps doesn't have the corrosion protection we'd like it to have. Sometimes the article, the device, the component will see high temperatures or aggressive environments during its operational lifetime. So we've got to put some thermal protection or perhaps some environmental barrier protection in there. Sometimes we want to change the characteristics of the substrate by putting a conductive coating on. So you can see there's many different functionalities that people may want to have on their engineered product. But ultimately what they are also after is durability. The product itself has got to last for as long as possible. It's got to do the job for as long as it possibly can do and at the highest level of operation. And it's got to survive the environment in which it faces itself. So when we think in terms of durability, we're thinking in terms of mechanical durability, scratch and abrasion protection, mar protection, erosion to perhaps sand or rain. Chemical survivability. So will it be seeing some harsh chemicals? Will it see, would be immersed in water and we start to get corrosion. And also photochemical. And that's the headline that we typically put on things that might be in the outside world and be exposed to sunlight for a long time. And that might cause some degradation. Just to put a little bit of a flavour to some of these questions and these challenges. So we've got an example here from the aerospace sector. So see a nice picture of an aircraft there. And there's a whole series of different surfaces that have got different functions, different capabilities, and need to be protected, need to provide protection to the underlying structure. So you can see near the engines, then we may have to have thermal barriers in order to protect perhaps temperature sensitive materials against the heat that is generated by the engine during operation. Corrosion protection doesn't really need an awful lot of explanation as to what we need there. One of the interesting things when we think in terms of the top coats is there has been a change over the years, certainly over the last 15 to 20 years, where people are now starting to put clear top coats on top of the painted surface. And what that does is it protects the painted surface from UV lights, so it reduces the degradation of the paint, so you don't get the discoloration that you used to get. So actually it provides the aircraft, and particularly the people who are running the aircraft, with liveries that stay nice and clean and sharp and retain the parent colour for much longer. So that's a process known as clear over colour. So a clear top coat over a painted substrate. And it's one example of how people can engineer surfaces. But of course, in an aircraft, you also have a whole host of environmental challenges that you have to face. So might be minus 50 degrees C up in 33,000 feet, 10,000 metres or so, where your typical flying height would be. And then you might come down to when the aircraft is on the ground, you might get up to 50 degrees C. So the entire structure and particular surfaces have got to survive those environments. And then you've got issues of question of drag, making sure that the aircraft flies through the air with minimum of drag, because drag means an increase in cost because there's an increase in fuel consumption. So there's a lot of work going on around the world in multiple laboratories where people are looking at how to change the drag characteristics of aircraft, both from an engineering design perspective, but also from a surface perspective, to reduce the amount of drag that is exhibited, so you can minimize the fuel burn. So you can reduce the amount of fuel that you may need to have on board, or you can extend the range of the aircraft, but also ultimately you move towards that global driver that we all face in every part of our lives, which is reducing the environmental impact of the activity. I thought it might be useful just to think in terms of some of the costs of surface contamination. And this is from one of our industrial member reports undertaken under our core research program a few years ago. And issues of transportation, you know, there's issue of fuel drag is fuel consumption due to aerodynamic drag. Just covered that a little bit in the aircraft sector, but it also occurs in other transportation sectors, so road transportation, but also in the marine sector. Heat exchangers is quite an astonishing fact that a quarter of 1% of the gross domestic product of every industrialized nation is lost due to surface contamination in heat exchangers, as the small channels in the heat exchangers get blocked up and you get loss of the efficiency of the heat exchanger. So it's an enormous challenge, and it's a challenge that is ongoing, and it's a challenge that really has got a lot of opportunities for people to address. But the challenges are, how do you make something that is cost effective as well as having the right functional capability? And I think that's where some of the technologies we'll be looking at briefly today will start to help. Wind turbines, you know, we've seen an enormous increase in wind turbines, particularly around the shores of the UK, where TWI is headquartered, over the last few years. But actually, you can get a reduction in the power output of a wind turbine by the change in surface contamination, by getting surface contamination. What we mean by that specifically is if you get ice buildup on your wind turbine, that can reduce power. But also if you get insect debris buildup, again, that has almost exactly the same impact, as well as erosion and the loss of the aerodynamic finish on the blades. Again, that reduces the power output that can be achieved. So actually, you can see from an asset management perspective, management of surfaces and reduction of surface contamination, making sure that your surfaces have got the longevity that you seek, can really be have a significant impact, both particularly in the operation and maintenance cost fields. But in the oil and gas sector, buildup of contamination on the interior of pipes that might lead to blockage of those pipes can actually lead to abandoned fields. And the costs for that could be absolutely astonishing. Estimated for one field, that value was 100 million. So just to give us a sense of the impact of surface contamination and the value of surfaces to engineering components, engineering products. TWI is a contract R&D and consultancy organisation. We get inquiries from our industrial members around the world all the time. What I've tried to do here is to put together some of the common inquiries that we face within the team in which I work. And these are often around ease of release coatings, durable coatings, coatings where surface contamination minimised to a great extent. And that might be on membranes and filters, there might be barrier coatings. We get questions from pretty much every industrial sector, and often these are very bespoke, but have common themes and common patterns. Chemistries, the application methodologies, the assessment methodologies often have some common links. So we're able to move relatively quickly between industrial sectors and provide guidance and support to our industrial members, regardless of the sector and the substrate. The way we do that is we try to ask what is the question and where does the question actually sit within the grand scheme of things. Are we starting right at the beginning? Are we thinking in terms of specification? Perhaps an industrial member has got a question. What coating should we use and how do we specify that coating? Or we've got a specification and actually some of the legislation has changed. So the products that we've used for years, we can't use, or we've got to change now. And again, the issue of legislation and regulation is one that is really quite significant in the coatings world, moving towards more environmentally responsible surfaces, but also starting to outlaw some of the technologies that have historically been used and often used very successfully from an application perspective. But the penalties in the broader environmental sense that means that they're no longer available. So we can provide people with help and guidance in terms of identification of alternative products, emerging technologies that might allow them to make some substitutions. We can also help people with the development of coatings, as well as characterization. If somebody has got a number of candidate systems, we can help them to evaluate between them and start to select the products that are perhaps best suited to their purposes. We can help them with validation, but also the implementation. Perhaps a new technology has come along for an industrial member and they're curious and they're interested in how they can actually integrate it into their manufacturing capability. And we can certainly provide a lot of guidance and support on that. So effectively, we can help our industrial members across the entire spectrum of technology readiness levels, as well as across all different coatings technologies, of which there are very many. But just trying to summarize our expertise in testing capability before I move into perhaps some examples and some details of the capabilities that we have available to us. One of the things that we offer our industrial members is the opportunity to undertake a process review and perhaps a specification review to help them to update their specification or to create a specification from scratch. Perhaps they've got a new functionality that they're looking for. We can help them with characterization and examination, and we can do that on a range of different coatings with expertise across the organization, from inorganic coatings, organic coatings, thermal sprayed coatings, plasma deposited coatings. We can provide a lot of guidance and expertise, and we actually have many of these coating technologies available within the business as well. The operational assessment and validation of coatings, as well as providing people with best practice guidance. Are we doing the right thing? Are our industrial members doing the right thing with the products that they're interested in? And if they start to go wrong, again, we can help out with understanding what has gone wrong. Is it something in the coatings technology? Is it the application? Is it the environment? Is it the selection? Or is there a problem elsewhere? And that fits in with the broader support that we provide all our industrial members, both from a failure analysis perspective, but also in terms of material selection. So materials and coating selection, as far as we're concerned here at TBI, go hand in hand. And of course, we can support people with coating application and formulation based on the facilities and the capabilities that we have. I'm now just going to give you an overview in terms of some of the characterization and examination capabilities that we do have. This is by no means a comprehensive list, but it's a No, it's a, we think, I think this is a good overview of many of the facilities that we have. Now, for those people familiar with the geography of TWI, so I'm based in our Cambridge headquarters, and we have many of our coatings capabilities here, as well as our examination facilities. But we also have a very well-equipped laboratory in Middlesbrough, in the TWI North facility. So again, when you come to us, we've got a whole range of different capabilities that we can pull together in order to provide you with that support. And some of the examples that we have here, so we've got a white light interferometer. So really powerful piece of equipment, actually. It allows us very quickly to examine surfaces. And we can do this from a 3D perspective, it's non-contact, but it provides close to nanometer resolution surface profilometry. So it allows us to analyze complex shapes, allows us to do them very quickly. There's relatively little preparation that one needs to go through. But also we can get a lot of very useful imagery from this device, as well as roughness measurements at the nanoscale across all the different roughness parameters, of which there are actually very many, surprising number of these, but we can provide guidance on which ones actually make the most sense with regards to any specific product. We also have, if we want to get to higher levels of resolution, so we could then use our AFM, atomic force microscopy. Again, surface mapping, it allows us to measure conductive surfaces or liquid cells. It gives us roughness values, friction values, and hardness values, because of course it is contact or semi-contact. But of course, the surface preparation of these samples is greater than it is for the white light interferometer. So what we recommend is that we would start off with the white light and then move on to the AFM if that is necessary. Unless, of course, the client is very clear and has good reason for going directly to AFM, more than happy to do that. The slightly higher scale in terms of the resolution, we've got a whole range of different optical microscopes available to us, phase contrast and backfield, darkfield, digital image contrast as well. So we've got a whole range of different capabilities. And we do have, of course, a contact profilometry as well. And in our Cambridge facility, we've also got an alicolor for larger scale samples, and it's a non-contact technique available there. So we can provide quite a lot of detail in terms of the microstructure and topographical examination. We can also provide quite a lot of guidance in terms of chemical analysis. So ferro transform infrared, we've got benchtop as well as portable devices. And these actually allow us to get some compositional data. And this becomes really valuable, very powerful, when you start to combine the compositional data with the topographic data that I've just discussed. And it allows us to get a better understanding of actually what those surfaces are. As frequently the samples we get have got very little information associated with them. But it also allows us to do some quite clever things, such as identify the degree of cure, for example, of coatings. It also allows us to identify degradation products, and particularly the portable FTIR allows us to qualify surfaces in the field, because of course it is portable, and tells us whether those surfaces are contaminated before we then do the next operation onto those surfaces. So in preparation for adhesive bonding, for example, or coating. So a lot of capability, a lot of facility, and flexibility is at the heart of much of our approach to undertaking these examinations. We've also got a range of thermal analysis equipment. So we've got thermal gravimetry. So this allows us to understand the mass change as a function of temperature of different systems. So these are polymers as well as coatings and perhaps candidate coating systems. We can also undertake differential scanning calorimetry to get really a clear quantified measure a whole range of different characteristics, again, frequently used within the polymers field. And the overlap in our scene between polymers and coatings is really very significant. So it can provide a lot of guidance in terms of the underpinning characteristics of a range of different systems. We also have the ability to undertake dynamic mechanical analysis, which allows us to get some key values such as storage modulus, glass transition temperatures of candidate systems or of systems that have already been produced. One of the things that we do often get asked for, and it's becoming an increasingly important part of our work, is the development of formulations, both for polymer systems and for coating systems. So we've actually got quite a useful rheological system within CDMI that allows us to measure the viscosity of a range of different mixtures. So we can create the mixtures ourselves, or we can bring in coating formulations, for example, paint formulations from manufacturers, and we can check what the rheology of those systems are over a range of different shear rates to measure things like how to get an estimate of flow index and rheology. That becomes really quite important when you start to look at highly loaded polymer systems. So if, for example, you have an interest in erosion resistance, erosion protection coatings that are applied from a wet coating perspective, typically what will happen is you will load up the coating system, the film former, with inorganic additives. One of the challenges with that is that those inorganic additives will often have a significant increase on the viscosity. And that's what the graph on the bottom right shows. But actually, there are some products that are out there that have got surface protection on the additives that can have quite a significant reduction in the viscosity of the loaded system. So you can start to change the rheological properties by managing the interfacial characteristics between the additive and the parent system, the film-forming system. We're also looking at some of these concepts with novel additives for polymer systems as well, in order to enhance the performance capabilities of those polymers. Because what we see a lot within the polymer field is that whilst fillers are added as relatively low-cost fillers, you can start to get some functional performance from those by increasing the amount that you put in, or by managing the interfacial characteristics between those fillers and the matrix material. So we've got a lot of expertise, we've got a lot of understanding, and we've got a lot of capability in terms of providing guidance on which fillers, how they might be modified, where you can buy these from, where you can acquire these commercially, or whether you can develop them yourselves, and how they will be integrated into a range of different coating systems. Following directly on from the questions of rheology, can we actually deposit coatings and can we apply coatings in order to do some testing? Well, the answer to that question is an obvious yes. We've got a range of different application methods, wet coating application methods within CDMI. We've got a range of different dispersion techniques available to us in order to make sure that we can get the most homogeneous blends for our clients. But also we've got wet coating capabilities. In particular, we've got two spray booths. We've got one based in Cambridge, and we've got one up in our Middlesbrough facility at Cedarbury North. And this allows us to apply coatings using conventional spray methodologies. And there's a range of different facilities that we have in terms of gravity fed as well as our spray. We can also put candidate systems down using conventional wire-wound bar application methods, and of course brush roller and spin coating we can do. So I'm hoping this gives you a flavour that we've got both a detailed understanding in terms of the examination of the coating systems, as particularly from a liquid perspective, that's more much of the work we do within my group is concentrated, but also the application of those coating systems, those candidate systems, either polyurethane, be they epoxy, acrylic, or any other of the wet coating chemistries. And then we've got the application of the coating itself, as I've described here. And then we can move into surface characterization. So we've got some other examples here. I mentioned in the early part of the presentation about surface contamination. And actually, one of the ways that we can assess, there are a number of ways we can assess that. But one of the fundamental underpinning factors behind surface contamination and contamination buildup is surface energy. And the surface tension of a liquid that might go onto the surface, or the surface energy of a solid contaminant, and how that actually influences the wetting, the wettability, as well as the repellency and the underpinning the adhesion of that contamination to a surface. And our starting point for understanding those characteristics are the drop shape analysis that we have in our Cambridge facility. So this is a cross DSA 100, which allows us to measure wetting, both static and dynamic, so we can achieve roll-off angles, but builds up a clear, very clear, very rapid picture in terms of the chemical characteristics of the surface and the contaminants that allow us to get a better feel for the potential contamination. Another way one can assess surfaces, and again, particularly look at things like contamination, is colour assessments. And we do have a facility to do this using the C-Lab colour measurement methodology. But this allows us to examine samples, examine surfaces, look at the colour of those surfaces and how they might change. For example, if they're exposed to surface contamination, or whether they are exposed to accelerated aging, which I'll come on to in a few moments. And does that colour change? Does that colour inform us about the chemistry of the surface and actually how that might impact the functional performance of the surface? We also have a solid reflectometer within CWI, and this allows us to measure things like the reflectivity of those surfaces to infrared. Particular importance when we start thinking in terms of the move towards reducing energy for example, the heating of houses. So it's well known that white surfaces give high levels of reflection. If you go to many hot parts of the world, then you will see buildings that are white. And actually this reflectometer will tell us, will give us a good idea in terms of what the reflection characteristics are of those surfaces. But as we move in the sort of more northern latitudes towards an environment where actually the solid reflectivity of windows, of roofs, is becoming important, then this piece of kit really is quite a useful facility in order to allow us to compare and contrast different surfaces. We can also measure the gloss of our of a candidate surface, either supplied to us by a client or one that we've prepared ourselves at the behest of a client. And also we've got quite an unusual piece of kit. We can measure surface area of additives that might go into coatings and paint systems. Actually extremely useful in terms of identifying whether things are porous or not. Moving into the tribology of coating systems, we find a lot of work, a lot of engagement with our industrial members in actually assessing the tribological properties of a range of different surfaces. Those surfaces themselves may be coated or not, they may be surface treated, for example, in order to increase hardness and so on and so forth. So this piece of kit, an extremely valuable, very useful piece of kit, allows us to assess the tribological characteristics of those surfaces over quite a wide temperature range. And you can see here, we go from minus 50 degrees C up to 1000 degrees C. So it allows us to undertake real-time assessments of questions relating to surface wear. We use them often for coatings, valves and pistons, but actually there's a lot of capability that this kit is able to provide. And it's what we offer to our industrial members as a facility for which we can start to examine some of their samples. And I'll give an example a little later on where we've used this as a case study. We've also got a simpler piece of equipment, the Chem Instruments coefficient of friction test platform, which allows us to undertake friction measurements on candidate surfaces according to the particular standard that's referenced there. These are some of the examples of the data that we get coming out of the tribal lab, looking at nano indentation and nano scratch, how do surfaces perform under a particular environment. So it's a very useful facility, the particular nano indenter, in order to provide an understanding in terms of particular operational environments. It allows us to map particular surface features across surfaces, perhaps across wells, or on looking at different candidate areas, perhaps ones that have been exposed to an operational environment. Now, it gives us a lot of information that we can feed back to to our clients in order to solve the question. And that's at the heart of everything we do. And then finally, in terms of facilities and capabilities, we have, of course, an environment performance assessment capability. Now, these are based up in our Middlesbrough facility. My colleagues up in Middlesbrough run these regularly on behalf of our members. We've got a dynamic climate chamber, which allows us to change the temperature range and the humidity range of really quite a wide range of values. And this is extremely useful in terms of providing thermal cycling data, for example, or humidity cycling data, or exposing samples to both changes in humidity and temperature. We have a QUV weathering chamber that is capable of both UVA and UVB illumination. And again, this is frequently used in order to give an assessment in terms of the weatherability and the weathering stability of surfaces, and allows us to compare many different samples at the same time. So we can expose them to condensing moisture, expose them to UV, and again, a range of different UV levels and UV types. So it's a very useful piece of equipment facility that we have. And of course, marrying with that, we've got our cyclic corrosion test cabinets, which provides us with the ability to do neutral salt spray and also cycle between ambient and 70 degrees C. We can also do both relatively high relative humidities as well as low relative humidities as well. So a range of different environmental assessment chambers where we can put components, samples, test coupons into in order to get an understanding of how they are likely to perform in an operational environment. Thinking in terms of the industrial sectors that we work across. So it'll come as no surprise to many of you, given the nature of TWI, that we work across every industrial sector. But what I wanted to do is to give an understanding of some of the questions that we frequently face from specific sectors. So within the aerospace sector, one of the areas that I mentioned earlier that is of particular importance is the question of anti-icing. How can you reduce surface contamination? How you can by ice, and how can you prevent icing forming? Because this has got both safety aspects, but also it has significant impact in terms of operational effectiveness, efficiency. Protective coatings for composites is becoming an increasingly popular topic that we're facing as the transition from towards a more non-metallic future starts to occur. Laminar flow coatings fits in with the surface contamination and reduction of surface contamination coatings. But also, and as I mentioned earlier, there's the challenge of changing legislation and regulations. So providing people with guidance and support is with regards to chrome-free, an area that we see increasing over the next few years will also be low fluorine-based coatings because legislation is and regulation is just starting to appear at the level of the European Commission and the US government, as well as other geographies where people are looking at the challenges of fluorine and fluorine-based materials and how they might have quite a significant environmental impact. So again, I would expect to see some impacts of that, of those considerations on the products that are available in the marketplace in the next 5, 10, 15 years. Moving on to so one other area that I should mention actually within the aerospace sector, but it also has cuts across into other sectors, which is the issue of recycling. Recycling of all components, or composites, recycling of coatings is one of the things that we see frequently coming from the within government funded programs, the issue of how do you recycle all of the products within your components. So that is the coating, it's substrate, it's everything within the engineered device. So recycling, reuse, upcycling, downcycling, all of those questions are areas that we are actively examining within CDY in order to provide supporting guidance to our industrial members. In the construction sector, we're looking at, again, surface treatments in order to provide dirt repellence. Thermal stability and fire and flame retardants is an area of significant importance. As we start to see an increased amount of bio-based materials that are being used, particularly within energy efficient buildings, so the protection of those and the reduction of particularly fire and flame sensitivity to them is becoming of increasing importance. But also the recycling aspect is an area that we see significant movement, and we anticipate significant movement over the next few years. Within the energy sector, I've already mentioned erosion resistance from a wind blade perspective, anti-fouling, low energy coatings for heat exchangers. So that is coatings that minimize the buildup of contamination for heat exchangers, as I mentioned earlier. Resin reinforcements, this is particularly in the non-metallic area, where we are also looking at the challenges of recycling particularly thermal sets. How do you address that question? Because the quantity of thermal set material that has been produced in order to satisfy the requirements, the demand, particularly for wind turbines, is significant. And one of the future challenges we see is how to recycle all those blades. So again, it's an area that we are investigating at present. Within the oil and gas sector, so barrier materials and coatings, particularly as we start to think in terms of the transition to non-metallics and permeability of non-metallic based products, how does one protect those against the permeation of some of the materials that might be transported? Enhanced polymers, polymer liners. So this fits within a much broader activity within TWI and the non-metallics activity that we have going on. That's quite a quick overview, quick summary in terms of some of the sectors and the technologies that we've got. What we try to do for our industrial members is make sure that the service we provide them fits with the test specifications that is important to them, their sector and their particular application and their component. So we've got a significant understanding of a whole range of different standard methodologies. We, as a business, we feed into many of the standard bodies to provide guidance in terms of what is coming through. And this is how we can also help our industrial members in terms of making sure that their specification for their coated products is fit for purpose. So as we move towards the latter part of the presentation, what I'd just like to do is actually cover some case studies. So we've got a number of case studies here. So this is a particular case study where we supported our industrial member from a material selection and process development perspective. So the challenge that the member faced was they found leakage around some guide vanes in a hydroelectric turbine. The turbine had been in operation for many decades, and it was having a significant operational impact. So they wanted to have an alternative coating, put a coating in place that allowed them to get this particular turbine through to the next phase of its lifetime, until it reached the end of its lifetime. So what we did is we undertook an analysis of what the problem was, where the challenge was. We identified a range of candidate materials. We sourced them, we tested them within our laboratory facilities that I've described. So we're looking at things like adhesion wear. We undertook some salt testing as well. And that allowed us to select a suitable candidate. We then, on behalf of our industrial member, did some on-site application trials, as well as providing them with some guidance and advice in terms of the application. And the original repair, which lasted 2 weeks, was changed to our recommended alternative, and that lasted until the turbine reached its end of life. So essentially what we did here is we reduced the repair frequency very significantly, and that provided our industrial member with significant benefits, both in terms of reduced downtime and also the cost and effort of having to repair, of applying the repair that they had previously selected. So this next case study is degradation study under accelerated weathering. This was part of a European funded program, the ModCom program. And essentially we used our facilities to expose some carbon fiber composites to moisture cycling, thermal cycling, as well as UV cycling, in order to get a better understanding of how these materials were degrading and changing. We were able to follow a range of different characteristics in order to get a better understanding of how these products were failing. What we could then do is provide guidance in terms of the protective coatings that could be used in order to provide a barrier to particularly the UV, which was the primary source of degradation of these composite materials, in order to make sure that these candidate systems, these emerging composite materials, actually survived UV exposure. So it also allowed our partners to then start to develop more accurate lifetime predictions of their materials. Within this, we also provided them with quite a lot of help and support in terms of working practices around nanomaterials as well. Again, an area that we're familiar with from the additives and fillers work that I mentioned earlier. Often we're asked to support our industrial members with failure investigations, and this is an example where a lead screw was failing. It was suffering seizures. And there was lots of suggestions as to what the problem may be. What we did is we actually undertook a set of examinations using our nano indenter and the advanced microscopy, the white light interferometer, in order to examine the components in detail. The hardness profile we were able to generate showed that there was a change in hardness from the crest of the valley within the lead screw, and that was the source of the challenge. We confirmed that through examination of our identification of microfractures in the crest of the bulk material, and this allowed our industrial member to change their component design, modify the component design to improve it. The end result was reduced equipment downtime and really significant cost savings. That's an example of not coating activity, but surface characterization. So coating selection, surface characterization, all form part of the same overall light sensor. The example on the screen at the moment, the case study here, is repellent surfaces for condensers. So I've mentioned earlier about the impact of surface contamination on condensers and on heat exchangers. But actually within heat exchangers and condensers, one of the real significant challenges is whether you get film-wise or drop-wise condensation of the working fluid. The loss of heat effect or the loss of efficiency due to film-wise condensation is well known, but actually addressing that by creating surfaces that provide drop-wise condensation has been very poorly understood. What we've been able to do within this program is to examine and to develop surface roughness characteristics as well as surface chemistries that actually allow a significant change in the wetting angle of the water in this particular case onto the surface. So we're able to change hydrophilic surfaces into hydrophobic, moving towards super hydrophobic surfaces by some relatively simple changes and the development and design of a really quite sophisticated but easy to apply surface onto those onto the interior of those condenser surfaces. We believe this is going to have a significant increase in the efficiency, the overall efficiency of the condenser of 1-2%, which, well, that might not sound a lot, is actually really quite significant enhancement. So this next slide actually shows some of the work that we've done on transparent repellent surfaces, particularly for the solar PV sector. Again, the amount of solar PV that has been installed around the world is really quite breathtaking and will continue to be so for many years. A lot of work has gone into the semiconductors that are used to translate the sun's energy into electricity. But actually one of the real challenges is often the contamination on the surface that can reduce the amount of light getting through to the semiconductor, to the device, really quite significantly. So the work that we've done allows us to put, say, transparent coatings onto our surfaces and actually increase the electricity generation by up to 3.6%. Really quite a significant impact. Again, it's an area that is of very significant interest and activity around the world. And we've been able to take our understanding of materials, of coatings, of applications, and of testing in order to develop and design products that are now actually being used by some of our industrial partners around the world. So I believe there's a facility in the Far East of 100 megawatts that actually has some of these coatings in use. From a surface contamination and a repellency perspective, did another piece of work. Again, this was a government funded program, Innovate UK funded program, Pristine. And what we're able to show here is by judicious selection of the coatings technology, we were actually able to develop a surface that significantly rejected the buildup of contamination, and the contamination that falls under the graffiti standard, which is referenced in the slide, is acrylic paints. It's actually used wax crayons as well, which came as a little bit of a surprise to us when we looked at it, but also permanent markers of different colors. And you can see on the bottom slide, so these are images courtesy of our project partner, LSBU, who were doing the trials and tests on the coatings that we developed. Actually, simple wiping with a domestic cleaner really showed on coating number one, we could remove all of the contamination extremely easily. The adhesion of the contamination to the surface was very, very low. So that was quite a successful project, and the industrial partners now looking at how they can build that into this technology into their product portfolio. So this is the penultimate case study that I just want to run through. And again, this covers a number of different technologies that I've mentioned already. So this is for composite manufacture. So the issue of composite manufacture is how can you detect the degree of cure of the composite during the manufacture of the resin? And the answer is to put a sensor in there. But the real challenge with the sensor is that you don't want the sensor to adhere to the surface of the composite while it is being processed. So within this program, we've designed and developed a coating system based on commercially available products that can be applied onto the sensor. It's a very thin coating, 1 to 2 microns. It's thermally stable. This particular coating, we believe, will operate up to 200 or 300 degrees C. It's part of a family of materials that are based on silicon chemistries that themselves can go up to over 700 degrees C. But this provides a high degree of repellence, but it doesn't prevent wetting. So it reduces the adhesion, but it doesn't prevent wetting. So we don't get a problem with laying the composite over the surface of the sensor. Now, this program is still ongoing, but we've got some extremely promising results at the moment because the coating that has been designed and developed actually is both transparent, gives very good adhesion to the sensor, thermally stable, and it also appears to be very durable to the operation. So it provides, we believe, a really useful opportunity for improved and enhanced composite manufacture in the future. So I've mentioned ice repellency a number of times during this presentation, so I thought it might be useful to give you an illustration of some of the results that we've actually achieved. This is from a project that is recently completed under the Innovate UK funding scheme. So again, a UK government funded program. We had two industrial members as part of the consortium that we were working with. And what we're able to show within this particular program is that we'd reduce the adhesion of ice from over 400 kilopascals using the ice adhesion method, testing method that we developed within the program, to less than 150 kilopascals. So quite a significant change. Also comparing that with some of the class leading products that are out there in the marketplace, we're able to identify that there was only one product that appeared to offer an even better performance than the product that we had. Now that is quite a rare product. It's available only from the US. And what we had was something with a coating that has been designed and developed and is available to our UK partners. So we think that's really quite a significant benefit. So we're now looking at how we build on this for the next phase of this development. Again, we're talking with our industrial members in terms of how we can do that. Just an example of the coatings themselves. So, summarizing, and we've got a few minutes before we for questions after this, but summarizing this presentation, surfaces are critical to success. There's no two ways about it. Surfaces are critical to the success of engineered products. Assessments and characterization of surfaces needs to be specific to the operational environment and to the materials that are being used. And we can support our industrial members with that. We can also help them to make sure that they select the best surface technology to achieve the functional performance that they're looking for. So on that basis, I'd like to thank you for your attention. So the list of contact people there on within the team. And so if you've got any questions that I'm not able to answer today, then please contact any one of us and we'd be delighted to reply to your questions. So, thank you. So Becky, do we have some questions? I believe we do.
Yes, we have. Do you want me to read them out?
Please, if you want me.
Okay. Would you please be able to show representation of results coming from pin-on-disc type of test? Does it include imaging? Is it weight versus revolution stroke time?
So we would be able to. Well, it's a good question. So I would need to, if I could take that question offline. So Becky, if we could capture who's asked, that'd be because we can only show data that we're actually able to release. So it depends on what basis that data has been generated. So I'll need to have a look and see if we have anything that is allows us to show that. But yes, we can present data to a client if that client has paid for that work across a range of different with a range of different metrics. So again, I can give a specific answer to that by email afterwards.
Okay. The next one is there any graphic showing differential or the type coating, adhesion strength, or coating sample?
Right. One could do that. I must admit, we tend not to do that because there's huge variance depending on coating chemistry, depending on surface preparation, depending on substrate, depending on the application method. So again, if you've got if you'd like to contact me directly afterwards, and if you've got something very specific in mind on that, then I can see if I can provide more specific guidance and more specific data. And we do have some of my colleagues within our surface engineering area will frequently talk about adhesion strengths of in excess of 50 MPa. Whereas with wet coating systems, you're looking at adhesion strength typically 5 MPa. But of course, it depends on precisely how you do that measurement. It depends on the substrate coating thickness and so on and so forth. So it sounds like there are a lot of caveats, and I'm afraid there are a lot of caveats, but yes, we can give some guidance broadly. But again, as I say, it does depend very much on the specific systems that are of interest.
Okay. Hi, Alan, many thanks for your talk. You mentioned in one of the case studies that you're anticipating degradation of properties of an epoxy with UV exposure. Why do you think this didn't occur during your investigations? Was this specific to the type of epoxy composite used?
In that particular one, so I believe that was ModCom. So we did see degradation occurring, but you can protect degradation from occurring within epoxy-based composites by the application of a coating, a protective coating. So that's how you would typically do that. Again, just jumping into the detail very quickly on that. So most epoxy-based composites are based on bisphenol A, and bisphenol A is photosensitive. So that's why most epoxy-based composites do have a protective coating on the surface.
Okay. Have you done much work with adhesives rather than coatings?
Yes, I have colleagues who spend all their time looking at adhesives. So, and the overlap between us is really very significant. So we talk very frequently. And a coating, as far as I'm concerned, is an adhesive on one side because you want it to adhere to the substrate. So yes, we have done quite a lot of work with adhesives. So again, if you've got a specific, if there's a specific query underpinning the question, then more than happy to pick that up. And I can put you in touch with my colleagues who works directly with adhesives, or maybe some overlap between us. So happy to do that.
Right. Are you or TLY carrying out a study on easy to apply paints that resist fire and that can be used as insulation?
We're not currently undertaking something on that particular topic, but we do have quite a lot of knowledge and understanding. There are actually industrial members of TWI that produce products that provide fire protection. And again, it depends precisely on what one is looking for from fire protection. So there's a range of different technologies that are available. So again, if somebody has got an interest in that, then we can provide some guidance. Again, one of the things that we offer our industrial members is the expertise that we have, both from the work that we undertake directly within TWI, but also our knowledge of technologies and products and capabilities that span our industrial network. So certainly one of the things I like to do is somebody's got a question and I know there is a commercial product available that will help to address that question very quickly. I like to point the questioner in that direction with the necessary supporting guidance that I can give them, because actually what most of our industrial members want is a solution quickly, and one they can access. And we can certainly provide a lot of guidance along those lines. If they want us to support them during that journey, we're absolutely delighted to do so.
Thank you. Any more?
I saw somebody called Andrew Dixon raise a hand a second ago.
Oh. Okay, Andrew, I've enabled your microphone if you want to ask your question.
No, that was a mistake from my side.
As far as
raising the hand is concerned.
Sorry, okay. That's fine. Okay, there doesn't seem to be any more questions. I think that is it, Alan.
Splendid. Well, I'll just remind everybody that if you do have any questions or you'd like to get in touch with me after this webinar, my contact details are up on screen at the moment. But if there are no other questions, I'd like to thank everybody for their attention, and thank you for attending this webinar. I hope you found it interesting and informative, and I look forward to hearing from you in the future, and I'd like to wish you a good day. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alan. And just to remind everybody, we will be sending out a copy of the presentation and the recording, and I will have Alan's details in that email for you all. Okay, thank you very much, Alan, and thank you to everybody else.
Thank you. Bye-bye.